Hi, I'm Senator John DeFrancisco, and this is my weekly program. This is a little interesting because usually I'm getting asked the questions, but today we have a special, special show. We have Breanna Stewart, the best women's basketball player in the world. No, actually in the country. She probably is in the world as well. But she's from my Senate district, the 50th Senate District, and she came on the program today to talk to me about the wonderful year that she had. Breanna, welcome.
Thank you.
Now, I'm going to give people a little bit of background. Last year, you won a national award as a high school senior. What was that award?
The Gatorade National Player of the Year.
Well, that's you say it so nonchalantly. You were the best player in the nation in high school.
The best female basketball player in the entire country. And since she's the best, she's going to be going to University of Connecticut next year and lead the University of Connecticut to another national championship in their long history of national championships.
And when you got that award, and based on your great performance during, since eighth grade, were you a varsity player? Is that what it was?
Yeah.
So for the years that you played varsity and the accomplishments that you had, I imagine there was a few schools looking to recruit you.
Yeah, there was just a few.
how many would you say you had offers?
I don't think there's you can put a number on it. I think that a lot of schools were interested in me, and it was just the ones that I showed interest back is where we kind of went along with the recruiting process.
And how many would you say you were seriously considering towards the end of that process?
Well, I made a list, so I had a top 10. And then I narrowed it down to three and then ultimately picked UConn.
And that's University of Connecticut.
Yep.
Now, University of Connecticut, I think, has more women's basketball championships than any school in the country, correct?
Yeah, I think right now we're tied with Tennessee at eight.
At eight? Oh, you're tied.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you'll take care of that next year.
Right.
And you got the clear Hall of Fame coach, Gina Auriemma.
Auriemma, yep.
Yeah, and what kind of coach is he?
He's a really intense coach. He's sarcastic, but at the same time, he wants to win, just like all of us, and wants to get the best out of all of his players.
Now, even though he has tied for the number of championships for the highest number of championships of all women's teams, he had a little drought there for 3 years, was it?
Yeah, it was a three-year drought.
Three-year drought. And then what happened? What changed this year?
I'm not sure what changed, but once the NCAA tournament started, it was kind of like a new team. We refreshed ourselves and then won.
Well, I watched the games. I watched all the NCAA tournament games, and I was really proud of you. I thought you not only handled yourself well on the court, but you were interviewed national television. Is that the first time you had an interview nationally?
I'm not sure if it's the first time. I think there's been times after games on ESPN and ESPN2, but never like that where it's after a national championship game and I'm the one being interviewed.
Well, you were certainly were well deserving. Now, how many tournament games were there that you won?
Six. I think you had to play six tournament games.
Six, and you had over 100 points in those six games. Is that correct?
I'm not sure about the stats.
Well, I know the stats, and you had over 100 points, and you probably had probably an average of about 7 or 8 rebounds a game and 3 assists, a few block shots, more than a few block shots. Your statistics were absolutely unbelievable. Now, during the year, first of all, you know that I played basketball at the Y with your father, Brian.
Right.
Now, this is what I remember about Brian. He was like a bull in a, what do you call it? Bull in a china cabinet or something like that?
Something like that.
But he was a bull. He had this unorthodox, not a shot. He actually threw the ball up at half court and then would push everybody out of the way, get the rebound, and put the rebound in. Did he ever do that or try to do that with you?
Well, I mean, we play one-on-one sometimes, and he has a nice shot. I'll give him that.
Oh.
But his half-court shot, I mean, he can make it, but I think that's the one you're talking about. He just throws it up there, and it just goes in, and I just look at him like, okay.
Well, that's good. Do you beat him?
Yeah.
That's good. When did you first start beating him?
When he was getting older. No, I'm not sure, but when I first did, he started to all of a sudden have sudden injuries, so, yeah.
As a father, I'm laughing because I know exactly what you're talking about. There was that day when my sons started beating me, and there was a turning point in my life. Now, there was another great, there was a lot of great players in the tournament, and I know there was another great team, Notre Dame.
Right.
And Notre Dame, during the regular season, had success with Connecticut. What was the difference when you played them was it the semifinals?
Yep.
What was the difference in the team, the Connecticut team, which made it so successful in that semifinal game?
I think the difference was from the other three games and that semifinal game was, I think that was the time where as a team we were all clicking together and flowing as best we had all season. And I mean, you could say that's a perfect time because it's the semifinal game leading into the national championship game.
Now, was that a tougher game for the team than the Louisville game, your final game?
I'm not going to say it was a tougher game, but both teams had really given us their all, and we needed to know the scouting report for each team.
Now, I mentioned your dad, and I watched all the games. I was rooting for you. I was like a little kid watching the TV, and they kept showing your mother and father, and I can feel what they were feeling. They were so proud of you. I mean, they were so happy to be there. It had to be the most unbelievable experience for them. Do you remember first talking to him after the championship was won, and what do you remember about that?
I think after the national championship was won, I remember seeing them back at the hotel because I didn't have a chance to see them after the game, but really just giving them a hug. I was glad that they were there and glad to have them share this with me.
Yeah, that was really great to see them. Now, the thing that I was impressed with the most, not only your numbers, but I couldn't believe the fact that you were in constant motion. Your conditioning was unbelievable. You weren't stopped for a minute. You would throw a pass to make a pick or go to the basket for a rebound or make an assist or step back for a three-pointer. And all the players weren't like that. I mean, some had to come out and they were tired when they came out on both sides of the team. You didn't seem to show that. I mean, what do you do for your conditioning? How do you get in that type of shape that you're able to do so many things and it seemed effortless?
I think that, I mean, obviously training into the off season and doing conditioning in the off season and continuing it through the season definitely helps, but I mean, it's the NCAA tournament and you don't have time to be tired. I mean, it's go time and you want to go and play the whole game. You want to be in the whole game.
But you were how much time during a game were you taken out generally? I was obviously like a pattern that your coach was using. Of the, 40-minute game, how many minutes would you say you sat?
I'm not sure how many minutes, but I think that especially going into the NCAA tournament, my minutes increased, and it was playing, you know, low 30s, 30 minutes a game.
And was there any other player on your team that had that same amount of playing time?
I'm sure, I mean, Kelly Ferris, obviously, she does everything, so I'm sure she was in majority of the games. And then usually it depends on what happens with fouls and stuff like that, because most people would play, but if they get in foul trouble, you have to obviously sit them.
Now, Kelly Ferris was a senior this year?
Yep.
What does she do now? Now she's a great basketball player during her 4 years of college at Connecticut. She was a phenomenal player. And now, what are her options at this point if she wanted to continue to play basketball?
Well, she actually is right now. She got drafted by the Connecticut Sun during the WNBA draft. So she's on their roster right now, helping them.
And they and that season happens pretty quickly after the NCAA tournament as far as women's basketball, correct?
Yeah, it's all very quick. I mean, the draft is like, I think, just a couple days after the season ends, and then you have training camp, and then you start because the WNBA season is only a couple months in the summertime.
Now, are there any other of your teammates that you had, your teammates this year, that are in the WNBA at this point?
Teammates from this year?
This year, yeah.
No, Kelly was the only one drafted.
Okay. And how about Brittany Griner? How is she, 6'8" or something?
Yeah, she's
6'8" tall. And she was got a lot of ink over the years. She had an incredible basketball career. Is she playing WNBA basketball?
Yes, she's on the Phoenix Sun with Diana Taurasi.
Who was at Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
She was one of the phenoms at Connecticut,
right,
that you probably watched when you were a kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, and did you ever think you'd be in the same position she was?
When I was a kid, no, probably not.
Yeah, well, it's terrific. Does Griner start in the pros?
I believe she does. Uh-huh. I mean, I don't think there's any way she can't because of her size.
And did you play her this year?
Yeah, we played against Baylor this year. Unfortunately, we lost.
But you won the ones that made a difference, the real ones, the last six games.
Exactly.
And that's the ones that made. And you were named the tournament MVP. And weren't you named the MVP of also an earlier round of the tournament?
Yeah, the regionals as well, I think.
Regional as well. Well, you peaked at the absolutely perfect time. Now, let's just talk about something totally different. You're a freshman in college right now. You got the world ahead of you. What are some of the things that you want to do? What do you envision yourself in the future doing, or some of the goals that you have?
Like future goals out of college,
yeah,
or still in college?
No, in college, I assume you want to do the best you can in your grades and in your basketball exploits. Let's fast forward 3 years from now. If all things go the way they should go,
mm-hmm,
and the way you'd want them to go, what do you see yourself trying to accomplish after college?
Well, after college, I hope to continue playing basketball in the WNBA, so hopefully get drafted. And also, 3 years from now, that'll be 2016. I'd like to play on the Olympic team.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, that's one of my goals.
You know, I never even thought about that. So you, when would they start picking potential players where you can?
I'm not sure. I know that next summer there's a world championship for the Olympic level. So I think that's when they start to figure things out. But hopefully I'll have a shot at it.
Well, I'm sure you'll have a shot. And who would coach that, not the Olympic game, but the game that's next year? You know yet?
I'm not sure. I mean, usually it's the Olympic coach, but they haven't named who the Olympic coach is going to be yet.
Has your coach been the Olympic coach in the past?
Yeah, he was the coach last year.
Do they change them every year, or the?
Sometimes they do. Sometimes they repeat a couple of years, but I'm not sure if Coach Ryan is going to do it again.
Well, number one, there's no question you're going to be on the Olympic team, and there's no question you're going to do whatever you want in basketball. And I was watching you like a young kid, screaming and yelling like I was playing the game myself, and it was very exciting. I'm proud of you. Central New York is proud of you, and we wish you the best of everything in the future.
Thank you.
I am very proud to welcome Brianna Stewart and her father, Brian Stewart, to the chambers today. Last year, if you recall, we brought her here and honored her as the number one high school women's basketball player in the country. And she was here with her team who won the state championship. This year, as a freshman, she was named in the semifinals of the women's NCAA tournament, played for Connecticut, the most outstanding player of the regional tournament, I should say. She was named the most outstanding player in the Final Four tournament. And despite all the great ball players in the past, there was only four others that won this honor of player of the year in the tournament. most valuable player since the history of the game. She's got three more great years to look forward to at Connecticut, and her performance was outstanding. Not only that, she's a wonderful young woman who handled herself with dignity when she was interviewed during the course of those games, and she is a wonderful person who has a fantastic academic record. And I told no one I would tell them till I got on the floor, but she's from my district. But no one could ever, no one was surprised by that because we bring so many champions here. So Brianna, congratulations on your wonderful success. Brian, as her father and relay to her mother, congratulations on raising such a fine young woman. And we wish both of you and your entire family the best of everything in the future.
Thank you for tuning in today. This was a great show for me. I loved watching Brianna. I loved talking to her. And she's going to be someone to watch and talk to over the many years to come. So thank you for viewing and have a great day.